So Crystal Palace sacked Patrick Vieira apparently in a 7 a.m. phone call. They're on 27 points. They're 3 points off relegation. Clinton, they've not won since December the 31st. But I have to ask, is he unlucky in the sense, you know, in the last few weeks, well, the last 11 games, 10 of the sides that Palace have played have been in the top half of the table. And now, after Arsenal, they've got a fantastic run coming up, potentially.
Yeah, I wasn't happy. I'll be honest with you, I wasn't happy. I speak to the chairman and I do speak to Dougie Friedman, director of football, but my opinion is I'm not happy. I think Patrick Vieira should have stayed there. As you just said, the run of games they've had, it's been really hard. But the next run of games they had, I think he could have turned it around, most definitely. I watched the Brighton game in midweek. They had two glorious opportunities to go and take the lead. If they score that and go 2-0 up, it's a whole different ball game. A few weeks ago, they 1-0 up against Brentford, conceding a 96th minute. Even Man City the other day, last week, you're thinking to yourself, they're going to get something. Then they give away a penalty in the 70th minute and then they lose 1-0. So they've been in games. It's not, and their biggest problem, and we've said this about Palace for two or three seasons, is putting a ball in the back of the net. So reliant on Wilfried Zaha, and that's what they've been doing upon season to get them goals. He's top goal scorer this season with 6 goals. He's been out for over a month and a half. He's only come back the last couple of games. So they're so reliant on Wilfried Zaha. And I do think it'll be the difference. But for me, I wouldn't have made that decision to sack Patrick Vieira. No chance.
Did Steve tap you up?
Yeah.
Because he saw your fantasy team.
Maybe yeah, he tapped me up. I said, Tim's available.
He said, no, you're all right.
No, he said, I'll think about it. No, but what...
In fairness, they can't afford to pay the same rates as Sky do.
There you go, mate. So, I'm here.
In the January transfer window, Crystal Palace brought in Lokonga on loan from Arsenal, a 20-year-old midfielder, yeah. Ahamada, who they paid around £10 million for. Last summer, they paid money for two players, Chick Doucouré and Chris Richards, who's played three league games so far this season. At the same time, they sold Christian Benteke and they are without Conor Gallagher. They are weaker this season, aren't they, than last season? Who's that down to?
Well, obviously, the objective has to be, with the business, what they've done, just to stay in the Premier League. And I think that they're capable of doing it with the squad they've got. But they're 12th in the league. They're nearer to Europe than they are to the drop. And I know it's tight down the bottom.
Not in terms of points, they're not.
No, of course it's not. But it's real. There's a lot of teams below them, Jeff. And they've still got to win games as well. So I think Patrick's very unlucky. But I also see it from Steve Parrish's point of view. You know, sometimes if you sit on your hands and you do nothing, you'll regret it. I always regret the things you do, not what you don't do. Mm. You know, so they've decided...
So you don't think they've been complacent in the transfer market?
I think they've been... Not complacent. I think he spoiled them last year. You know, completely changed the philosophy of how they played from the Roy Hodgson side. And the players looked like they were enjoying it, like Eze and Elise and Wilfred. You know, they were getting on the ball, they were exciting, but they're not doing it this year. You know, they've got AU, who I had at Aston Villa, who runs around, tries his best, but can't score goals. You know, Edouard, you know, they've got a lot of players there who just cannot hit the target. So you're absolutely right. Everyone's looking for the same player. They could not find that player, the one who's going to put the ball into the back of the net. And they probably hope that Patrick would be able to develop the ones they've got to be able to achieve it. It hasn't materialised and they've made a decision.
You know what I'd say, Jeff? The biggest player they've missed this season, and you named him a minute ago, Conor Gallagher. Because he'd get you goals from midfield and he presses the life out of teams. And that's what they've missed. When I watch a lot of Palace, who's going to set that press? Conor Gallagher used to go and set that press. And I think they were desperate to get him in the January window. It didn't materialise and they've missed him. But I'm in agreement with Tim. I think Vieira's bang unlucky.
When we talk doors about the lack of backing in the transfer windows for Patrick Vieira, I think it's fair to say that Steve Parrish, the forefront of his mind, will be the future of the football club because they don't have massive financial backing like many of the other clubs do.
For sure, Jeff, and I think everyone at the top of a football club, they believe that they have the best interest in what they're doing. And did Steve Parrish want to stack Patrick Vieira? Probably not. He was probably thinking, I've got to react to something. Nine of the bottom teams, six of them clubs have changed managers with Patrick going yesterday. So that's because the fear of relegation is so superior to these football clubs. They think, if we do nothing and get relegated, will I look back to this break just before the international? Should I have done it then? And they are at the top for a reason. They make decisions. For me, it's a wrong decision. I would have stuck with him. I honestly believe that. Not just going with the guys. I think we talked about what Patrick Vieira did last year for Crystal Palace. Before the turn of the year, before the World Cup, we talked about the form they were in, very good. How were teams going to react when they came back? They have had a nightmare. They haven't reacted. They've only picked 5 points up from 11 games. That isn't good enough. So I do see why they've changed it, but I would have stuck with him. And they're a team that, look, they're 12th in the league. Yes, only 3 points above relegation, but you've just talked about the teams that are coming up. He's played all the teams above him. So that's what's tough. It's not about beating them because they're not in the same league. Well, they are in the Premier League, but they're not competing for the same objective at the end of the season. If they can finish 12th, which I still believe they can if they beat the teams in around them. Yeah. When you're in a relegation battle, it comes head-to-head, and if we beat them, there we go. You see Wolves leave today. That is a massive game because it's head-to-head.
But, Mus, why have they done it now? Because if you look, they've got Arsenal coming up on Sunday, international break after that. Then they've got Leicester, Leeds, Southampton, Everton, Wolves and West Ham, all winnable matches.
All cup finals, isn't
it? I'm lost. I'm with the lads. I'm lost with... You know, the games they've lost, they've never been favourites to win any of them games. They've not been expected to win any of them games. Even the games at home. You've got to put that in perspective. You've got to know enough about football to go... We're playing these teams. We're not good enough to beat these teams. You always have to work hard to beat Palace. They're not getting blown away. They're not getting embarrassed. They're not in the end of results where they're spelling out the number as well. That's when you're getting hammered. I mean, you get this game out of the way, have 2 weeks to work, and then give him two more games or three more games. They play, you know, I think they play two games in quick succession. I think it's the first and the fourth or something like that. I think it's two games. I think we have a double header. Giving them two games. This manager is... I hope they haven't got this horribly wrong. I hope they haven't got it horribly wrong because there's a lot of traffic in between them. Yeah. A lot of traffic. And these teams ain't all going to win games. You know, one win and it's all over. They're finished. They're out of it. And, yeah, I find it a bit panicky. I understand what Tim's saying at the same time. You sit on your hands. I get that as well. But this manager's going to come in tomorrow... I'll pick the team now. I'll tell you what the team's going to be.
Clinton.
He's going to pick the Patrick Vieira team.
Clinton, is that manager going to be Roy Hodgson, do you think?
Oh.
Well, he's the favourite. He's the favourite. But you're going to ask me now if the fans are going to be happy. Listen, Roy Hodgson done a fantastic job there. But that's like you take 2 steps forward and now you go 2 steps backwards. Listen, he's come in before when De Boer struggled and came in and kicked the club up. If it's from now to the end of the season... And it looks like he is going to be the favourite because you can see
it's a one-horse race.
Well, there you go. Well, then it is going to be. It's going to be Roy Hodgson from now to the end of the season.
Clint, on that list, who would you rather have?
I'd rather have Ralph Hasselhoff.
Patrick Vieira.
Obviously Patrick Vieira is there, but I'd take Ralph Hasselhoff all day long. I think he's a brilliant manager and do well at that club.